Hey everyone, welcome back to Rust and Relaxation. We've got a lot to talk about today. Today, I'm recording this commentary on December 6th, Saturday. And those of you who've been following current events will be well aware already, I suspect, that yesterday the Game Awards were held, and today is the first out of a two-day PlayStation Experience Expo. So, quite a lot has been announced yesterday and today, and I have a feeling quite a bit more will be announced later today and tomorrow. I'm recording this commentary by American reckoning fairly early in the evening. So, the PlayStation Experience Conference is actually still going on even as I speak. And tomorrow, when I release the next episode of this playthrough, I'll be getting to some of the details that have yet to be released as of this recording. So first of all, I wanted to start with the Game Awards, and I did want to get to some questions and comments as well, but I fear we're going to have too much else to discuss this episode, and I may or may not actually end up getting to them. There were a couple of interesting things that came out of the Game Awards yesterday. The first of which was that Shovel Knight won Indie Game of the Year. So congrats to Yacht Club. Awesome, guys. I'm really happy to hear that. There was some contention that I guess some people felt Transistor should have won instead. I haven't actually played Transistor, and don't get me wrong, it looks like a great game. I don't think it's any less deserving than Shovel Knight. But looking at the difference in the type of each of those two games, I think probably Shovel Knight won it because it has a wider and more universal appeal. Transistor is, for those of you who haven't seen it, it's kind of a more strategy-oriented and tactical, not really tactical because it's an action-based game, but it's got some more RPG elements in it, whereas Shovel Knight, I think most of you are probably already aware by now, is just straight-up old-school 16-bit-ish action. So, I think probably the nostalgia factor was part of Shovel Knight's decisive win there. I know it certainly strikes the nostalgia chords for me. So, my feeling is that that's probably why the result ended up being what it was. Nevertheless, congrats to Yacht Club, because that's not a small accomplishment. For those of you who haven't seen their one-month sales breakdown, I'm going to put a link to that in the description. You really should read it, not only because it gives you an idea of why the game was as popular as it was, maybe, but more importantly, it's kind of an expose from an indie studio. And for those of you who aren't familiar with Yacht Club games, it's only six guys. And most of them used to work at other more prestigious developers prior to forming Yacht Club, and just ended up breaking off. They explain all of that in their sales breakdown. It's really as much an explanation on why it's not easy to be an indie developer, or at any rate, a successful indie developer, but how they managed to make Shovel Knight as much of a success as they did by, you know, putting in months of work without pay, risking their entire financial security and livelihood, and making all kinds of sacrifices and compromises, and just putting in their all to make it a good game because they cared. You know, not because they were trying to make tons of money, not because they were trying to make a name for themselves, but just because they wanted to make a good game that people will love. And I've talked a little bit before about the difference between the attitude and just the general nature of the indie game community, the indie developer community, as opposed to the AAA developers that have up to now really dominated the market. Later, idiot! Wrath of God is such a fun miracle. But you guys really should check that out, that 1 month sales projection, because it's a really enlightening document, and well worth reading if you have any interest in indie games. It kind of gives you an idea of the things that AAA developers either can't or won't tell their customers. And for those of you who are interested in what it's like to be a game designer, the sorts of obstacles that you have to overcome, and the hurdles that you face, and even some of the ways in which it's rewarding, and possibly the differences between how an indie developer does it and the level of freedom an indie developer has over maybe a AAA studio. Really an educational read. I highly recommend it. Again, the link will be in the description. Go check it out. And in connection with that, I'm going to come back to this at the end of the video because I don't really want to overlay anything onto the gameplay here. Not that there's much exciting going on at the moment, but now here I was just trying to see if there was any actual collision in these cells. And it turns out that there I guess, kind of is. I was able to fire an arrow through the gate into them, so I was kind of expecting it to just be a solid wall and the gate was just aesthetic. Just a texture. But in any case, at the end of the video, after the footage is over, I'm going to show you guys an excerpt from a backer email that I received about a week ago from Concept, a Mighty No. 9 backer email, which I intend to show you guys as sort of just a way of highlighting, again, the difference in attitude between a lot of indie developers and the AAA industry. And I want to show you guys that excerpt just to kind of highlight a little bit about why I feel indie games are really going to be the future of gaming. They're increasing in prominence, and there are a lot of really excellent titles either that are coming out, are already out, or that are in alpha or pre-alpha and still trying to get their Kickstarter campaigns off the ground, maybe. We'll talk a little bit more about that at the end of the video when I can actually show it without covering up any of what you're seeing here. I do want to talk a little bit about this area, though. One of the interesting points that came up in the discussion of the past couple of episodes, especially the last one when I answered the question that Keln asked about the difference in healing balance between the Souls games. Until the Artorias of the Abyss DLC was added, humanity was fairly annoying to get. The only places you could get it really reliably were either the little baby skeletons right outside Gravelord Nito's boss room, which respawned infinitely but were a huge pain to fight, or you could also get it by... Oh god, there's another place, and I'm trying to remember off the top of my head where it was. The Mind Flayer type enemies in the Duke's archives in the prison, they drop it. But getting in there to farm them is a huge pain because you can't warp to the bonfire in the prison and you can't warp out from it. So you have to go to the next closest bonfire to that is the one in the closed off half of the archives. Really annoying to get humanity in either of those ways. As you can see here, though, these humanity enemies in the Dark Chasm, there are tons of them. They're all over the damn place. And they have a ridiculously high drop rate, not only of regular humanity, but of twin humanities. So, fairly early on in the game, really just as soon as you get the Lord Vessel and can unlock the Duke's Archives and go get the Broken Pendant, you can just come here and fight your way through Artorias and just farm the crap out of the Dark Chasm and get yourself two stacks of each type of humanity, because you can hold a stack of each type in your bottomless box and then another stack of each type in your inventory. So this is objectively the best and easiest and by far the fastest place to farm for humanity. And a number of people brought up differing points and differing arguments as to whether it was a good or a bad idea for humanity to heal hit points. A number of you guys responded to my argument that humanity being able to heal was a bad thing. And some of you made some very compelling arguments to the contrary. In particular, Alexi Leclerc pointed out that, I'm guessing Alexi Leclerc is female? Alexi is a girl's name? I can never tell, guys. On the internet, men are men, women are men, and little girls are FBI agents. So damned if I know. But Alexi LeClerc pointed out that he or she is a PvPer and likes the fact that humanity recovers HP, makes the very good point that it's without humanity being able to heal your health, fight clubs would not really be possible, or not to the extent that they are. And I think what Alexi is referring to there, and actually I believe she actually explained this in the comments, was that if you have a host in the forest who is running a fight club and summoning or just being invaded by black phantoms and forest guards and dark moon blades and just random schmucks using cracked red eye orbs. What a fight club is, for those of you who aren't familiar, I imagine most of you probably are, but I think for those of you who've started with Dark Souls 2, the concept of fight clubs may or may not be something that that is familiar to you. It's something that really originated in Demon Souls and became, I think, more proliferate even in Dark Souls 1. Fight clubs are essentially a host uses something like the Dried Fingers to reset his or her invasion timer and constantly get invaded. Typically in an area where invasions by other types of phantoms beside Dark Wraiths are possible. Again, the forest is a really popular spot for it because you can be invaded by just about everybody there. Again, the Dark Moon Blades, the Dark Wraiths, non-Dark Wraiths using cracked red eye orbs, the Forest Covenant members, and just about everybody in between. So you get all kinds of... You can also summon phantoms there. People will often put down their soul signs. So often Sun Bros and other people will get involved as well. This is Alvina, by the way. And you're normally supposed to fall down to her from up above. I'm approaching from the rear, as it were. The idea here is that she's trying to lead us to somebody who needs saving. So we're going to just proceed on down that direction. Normally, if you fall from up above here, you don't take fall damage, which I think is what that white mist is supposed to signify. Just that falling down from there, Alvina, I guess, is supposed to prevent you from being damaged with her magic, I guess. But, Alexi LeClerc pointed out that in the ability to recover your HP with humanity, you gain the potential power to have black phantoms and other invaders show up who cannot heal themselves with Estus. And if they win a fight in the fight club, for example, if an invader shows up and a Sunbro is present, and the Sunbro then goes and has a one-on-one duel with the invader, and the invader or the Sunbro win, but they're at really low health. Being able to use humanity gives them a way of recovering their health and being ready for the next match, the next opponent who invades the host. And that's a good point, you know? I didn't frankly think of that when I mentioned the disadvantages of humanity recovering HP in terms of game balance. But a number of other people also pointed out in the comments that, and you're absolutely right, guys, it's really kind of, no matter what you do, it's somebody is going to lose out. It's extremely difficult, if not outright impossible, to balance, to use the same healing system for both PvE and PvP, and have it be completely balanced for both purposes. And hey, look, it's little baby Sif. Sif is actually, we're going to find out a little bit later more about him, but Sif was a friend and companion of Artorias. And this is another point that somebody asked me in the comments. I don't remember whom, I apologize. I don't think I wrote this one down. But somebody asked me, why did Artorias attack Manus and tackle the Abyss alone? And in point of fact, he didn't really. He came here with Goth and Kieran and Sif. So, you know, Anne Orlando had a fairly big stake in Ulysseal's survival, from what we can tell. This is Artorias' shield. And the reason he's never shown using it is because you'll recall from the past episode that his left arm is broken. Or his shield arm is broken. I forget exactly which one of his arms are broken, but I think it's his left arm. And the idea is that his arm was broken fighting Manus, and he used his shield, as we just learned from the description, to form a protective barrier to protect Sif, so that Sif could survive and hopefully be rescued by somebody, which ended up being us. But the reason that Artorias actually ended up fighting Manus alone is because, and I'm going to have to go back and get his original sword. I'll have to, when I get my hands on the soul required to upgrade that sword, I'll be able to show you guys the description. But basically, Artorias was obviously one of the gods. He had no ability to walk on the abyss on his own, as the gods don't. His way of getting around that was to actually form a covenant with the serpents of the abyss. It's implied that it was Darkstalker Kath, although it's never outright stated. But we also know that there is more than one serpent, and in fact, more than two. In the Dark Lord ending of this game, we see that there are quite a few serpents, and presumably the majority of them, and this is another question I was asked, so many lead-ins, presumably the majority of the serpents, as they are described to be imperfect dragons in the flavor text of the Covetous Rings, probably being related to dragons, they want to see the gods overthrown. They want to see revenge exacted on the race that originally usurped their kin. So, this is a point that Marcus brought up a long time ago about the serpents being imperfect dragons, and I agree with it. It's an excellent observation, to be completely honest. So, Artorias had to form a covenant with the creatures of the abyss in order to be able to walk on it. You'll note, and I'll try and show you guys next time we go back to New Londo, if you try and enter that boss room in New Londo that I walked past when we were first there, if you don't have the Covenant of Artorias, which is a ring that allows you to walk on the abyss, if you enter that boss room, the minute your feet touch the ground will basically eat you, and you'll see a unique death animation and get a unique death message which says you were taken by the abyss. And that's what happens if normal people try to walk on the abyss. So Artorias knew he needed to defeat Manus, and in order to do that, he needed to get around not being able to walk on the abyss. So he formed a covenant with the creatures of the abyss. And actually, when you finish fighting the four kings, you become able to walk on the abyss yourself, which makes a little more sense if you haven't already spoken with Kingseeker Frampt, because if that's the case, Darkstalker Kath will show up, and there's a very vague implication that it's actually Kath who gives you the ability to walk on the abyss after the four kings are defeated. Or perhaps just that you gain the ability to walk on the abyss by defeating the four kings. Again, it's not clear. Nobody can really say for certain. So, the reason that Artorias's companions, Goth and Kieran and Sif and the others, weren't able to follow him into the abyss is quite simply that they lack the ability to walk on it. And that Dark Bead spell that we just picked up, the reason it was so heavily guarded is because it is the single most broken spell in this game. And I think maybe, you know, I'll just put a link in the description to a video I made a while ago where I tested Dark Magic in Dark Souls 1 for the first time. And if you guys want to see why Dark Magic is so stupidly overpowered in Dark Souls 1, check out the video that I'm going to link in the description. I think it'll be pretty clear pretty quickly why Dark Bead is such a ridiculous spell. To put it quite simply and concisely, I was able to do about 6,000 damage with it to Executioner Smo in the Ornstein and Smo fight in, I think, one or maybe two casts. So, yeah, it one-shots human players almost all the time. You do not want to get hit with Dark Bead. And granted, you don't want to get hit with any dark magic. Dark Orb is bad enough. Pursuers is pretty crazy. Pursuers, by the way, is the precursor of the Affinity spell in Dark Souls 2. Basically the same spell, just under a different name. So, yeah, guys, that hopefully will answer some of the questions that have been raised about the a little bit of the lore going on here. Now, let's talk a little bit about... I want to get back to the PlayStation Experience conference, because there was, so far, there have been quite a few interesting new games announced. There was a third-person shooter game that takes place in the notebook of a high school student. It's really fascinating stuff. Of great interest to me, obviously, is the fact that Hidetaka Miyazaki himself put in an appearance on stage to introduce a couple of new mechanics in Bloodborne, namely the free dungeons, as they're called. They're essentially a procedurally generated dungeon that he described as resembling, or having features of anyway, roguelike games. And they actually showed a good deal of gameplay, so plenty of in-engine evidence as to what that feature is going to be like. A lot of really interesting potential there. The procedurally generated dungeons possibly add a lot of replay value, particularly considering that they're going to be different each time, and you can summon other players to help you out with them. They showed some aspects of the multiplayer in that boss fight as well. I will put a link in the description to PlayStation's stream on Twitch, their Twitch archive, rather, of the PlayStation Experience conference, and I'll put a timestamp for Miyazaki's little presentation of Bloodborne as well, so that you guys can find it quickly and easily. It wasn't very long, but it was very informative and quite revealing, so definitely worth a watch if you're interested in Bloodborne. Also, they recently released another trailer of Bloodborne showcasing, and I had to laugh at this, showcasing the boss fight with Father Gascoigne. And I have to think that they chose that particular content for the trailer because Sanedsk decided he was going to jump the fence in the online alpha test and find his way to that boss fight when he wasn't supposed to, and then upload it to YouTube. And he very quickly got a C&D and a takedown notice, as you might expect. But the damage was done, you know? Everybody at that point had already found out about it. There are animated GIFs all over the place and of Father Gascoigne saying, "Umbasa." So I figure FromSoft probably decided, well, shit, now we have no real recourse other than to show this in a trailer. That's my guess. I can't say that for certain, but it seems like the logical step to take after a leak like that. And I don't know why they didn't think people would try to do that, to jump over the barriers and explore other areas. I don't know. I hope that this kind of gives them a better idea of how dedicated their community is to finding out everything about their games. So I don't know. We'll maybe have a little bit more to speculate on sometime in the future in that regard. But another thing I found hilarious about the PlayStation Experience conference, and I had to roll my eyes at this because, like, this is very, very typical Square Enix these days. So many companies are just rolling out these really interesting new games. Hello Games did another trailer for No Man's Sky. A lot of interesting stuff is on the docket. And the schedule for PlayStation Experience actually indicates that there's going to be another Bloodborne presentation later. I'm going to try and catch the stream for that. I hope they do actually show it on stream. But The presentation that Square Enix did, if you could even call it that, it was like a 3 or 4 minute announcement, not even, it was 2 or 3 minutes, really, a brief announcement that, hey guys, we're bringing the PC version of Final Fantasy VII to PS4, yeah, we're still relevant, really, look, we're making a direct port, you know, we couldn't be bothered to upgrade the graphics at all, or, you know, actually make it redo the engine for PS4. We slapped together this port in about 15 minutes, but hey, you know, we just wanted to let you all know that we're still alive. Please buy our games. God damn it, Square Enix. This is why nobody likes you guys anymore. Oh well. So, we're gonna fight Manus now. And those of you who followed my previous Dark Souls playthrough will recall that in that playthrough, I showed the cheese strategy for Manus, which was essentially standing on the cliff where I just stood a couple of minutes ago and looked down into the boss room to show that you can actually see his glowing red eyes down there. If you have a bow with long enough range and the Hawk Ring, you can manually aim your bow in third-person mode and headshot Manus. And with the red tearstone ring and a large enough supply of arrows, you can kill him from outside the boss room. I took some flack for that last time. A lot of people were like, oh, you're so cheap, you're so cheap. All I was really trying to do was show an alternate way of defeating him if for some reason you're having tons of trouble. I say if for some reason. Personally, Manus is one of the cooler boss fights in Dark Souls 1, in my opinion. And this time, I felt he really deserved a proper face-to-face man fight, to borrow a demoism. So, we're going to go show Manus our face-to-face man face. And yeah, that hand, that's Manus. And we're going to talk a little bit more about the lore implications of Manus after the fight. But essentially, Manus is the pygmy. He is the progenitor of the human race in Dark Souls 1. And he himself was originally human, as we're going to learn from the description of his soul. He was, in fact, the first human. But now he is this, because his humanity went nuts. And we've got to put the poor guy out of his misery. So he is very central in the lore of Dark Souls 1, and he's one of the few consistent elements that are mentioned, and in fact, in his case, not directly mentioned, but constantly alluded to in Dark Souls 2. And in all of the references in Dark Souls 2, which mention, oh, the abyss was fragmented and broke into pieces when the creator of the abyss was defeated. This is the creator of the abyss that they're talking about. When Manus was defeated, the lore of Dark Souls 2, such as it is, holds that his soul or his essence fragmented into different pieces and became the sisters, the Manus sisters of Dark Souls 2. And that is Nashandra, Alsana, Elana, and Nadalia. The four of them are actually, they were born from the shards of Manus' soul, as is held by the lore of Dark Souls 2. Manus, unlike any of the four of those sisters, Manus is a substantially interesting and also difficult boss fight. And granted, two out of those four sisters are not boss fights at all, even. So, you know, take that for what it is. But Manus, as you can see, he is no joke. He's got super awesome combos. He's got super dangerous dark magic. And in fact, he uses almost all, if not all, of the player dark magic, except his versions of it are much better, obviously. And this is where the silver pendant comes into play, which I believe you guys are going to see as soon as I get his health down a little bit more. Yeah, here it is. There we go. So, as you can see, the silver pendant gives you a protective barrier that completely blocks the dark magic. Unfortunately, it does not block his 6 or 7 hit combo. Manus confirmed for Street Fighter V, except not really. Yeah, that's his version of Dark Bead, and I hit the silver pendant just a little bit too late. And I deflected most of the shots from that spell, but just enough of them hit me to just barely kill me. So I figured I'd cut ahead to my successful attempt against Manus. Frankly, it took me several attempts to get the hang of fighting him again, because he's kind of a difficult boss to fight just on reaction. He does telegraph his moves to the degree that, in most cases, you can respond to them. But some of them, even when you see them coming, like a lot of his jump attacks, if you aren't in exactly the right spot, there's just nothing you can do to get out of the way. Like, unless you are positioned at a very specific distance from him when he initiates some of those jump attacks, their hitbox is large and wide enough that you will get hit by them no matter what you do. And this one, especially the overhand smash, you really have to know the exact dodge timing on that, because that particular move, it tempts you to want to roll early, and if you do, you'll get hit. And if you get hit by that, it does a lot of damage. Now, there is one other very interesting element of this boss fight, which is that if you happened to rescue Sif, we're going to, and as a matter of fact, I'm going to show it here, we actually get to summon him as an ally. Check this out. Yeah, that's Great Grey Wolf Sif there. And they were, I love this, they had the foresight even to allow you to summon him just by examining his sign. Ordinarily, there would be a prompt, and you would have to say, yes, I want to summon this NPC. Because they knew that you would have to summon Sif in mid-battle, and that having to deal with that prompt could get you killed, they eliminated the prompt and just made it so that by examining the sign, just pressing X once on the prompt, you would instantly summon him. I love that. It's really excellent attention to the mechanics of the fight. And it shows the awareness and the consideration that that these guys had for what you'd be dealing with when you had to summon Sif. And look at it! I mean, my god! Puppy Sif is helping us fight Manus. This to me was the moment where I really, the first time I played through this DLC, this was the moment where I said, you know what? Ordinarily, I'm skeptical of DLC, but boy, did they nail this. Boy, did they nail it. And a lot of people have been asking me in the comments, Franz, what are your opinions about the Dark Souls 2 DLC as opposed to Artorias of the Abyss? And to be honest, guys, I don't think it's really fair to compare them. The Artorias of the Abyss content was originally planned to be part of the base game. It wasn't supposed to be DLC at all, and it was written, into the plot of the base game. It was intricate to the plot, and they had a lot of trouble removing it when they weren't able to fit it into the base game due to completely legitimate time and budget constraints. So when they eventually reintegrated it as DLC, there were certain things that they had to retcon, which they had originally removed in order to retcon it the first time. But for the most part, it fit in fairly seamlessly. The Dark Souls 2 DLC, you'll probably recall that both Namco and FromSoft stated outright they never had any plans of releasing DLC for Dark Souls 2. So they didn't have anything written for DLC, certainly had nothing prepared in advance that had received full development assets, full development time. None of that was ready in advance. Rather, they put together the Dark Souls 2 DLCs really at the last minute, and only when they realized what a big seller Dark Souls 2 had been, and that there was more money to be made by releasing DLC, that it was financially viable, and that they had a large enough audience that they could expect significant sales numbers. So, I don't think any of the Dark Souls 2 DLCs really compare, simply in the very nature that they were not written to be part of the base game. They were add-ons that are kind of just very generally and vaguely written into the story as an afterthought without really a lot of tie-in. And guys, I know I criticize Dark Souls 2 a lot, but there are certain elements of those DLCs for which I have a lot of praise. The Fume Knight and Sir Alon, I think those are the two best boss fights in Dark Souls 2, to be quite honest with you guys. And the only two that I can think of off the top of my head, really, that compare to some of the bosses in Dark Souls 1, like Manus. And I love how Sif even has a unique victory animation there. He'll howl and then sit down. I think, unfortunately, I missed the howl because I had my menu open. But, I think, really, in my opinion, oh, Dusk. In my opinion, the Artorias of the Abyss DLC vastly beats out any of the three DLCs for Dark Souls 2. But I would say, of the Dark Souls 2 DLCs, I don't know, I really don't think it's a good idea to get into that, because it's just going to end up mostly being my criticisms of them. But again, my favorite elements of the Dark Souls 2 DLCs were the Fume Knight and Sir Alon. Now, let's talk about Manus. This, as you can see, is a very obviously coffin-shaped or human body-shaped grave. And this is where Manus was originally buried when he was human. So he was buried there as a human. The pygmy, who is actually shown in the opening CG of Dark Souls 1, the pygmy is the right shape and size to have fit into that grave. So that is some fairly substantial corroborative evidence that, considering this is where we fight Manus, and considering some of the dialogue we're about to get in a little bit later, in fact, I think right now, Goth will outright tell us that the people of Ulysseal awoke that thing and drove it mad. We're going to look at Manus's soul a little bit later, too. This is Hawkeye Goth. Let's talk to him. See what he has to say. Really cool guy. Oh, and actually, I think before we talk to him, I wanted to show you guys, this is his bow. So yeah, the Four Knights of Gwyn, they did not mess around. Hawkeye Goth was a giant. And we're going to talk a little bit about his helmet as well, because he's going to tell us that he's blind. And actually, the description of his helmet says that he is not in fact blind, but the people of Ulysseal, who were kind of racist against giants, they packed his helmet with pine resin so he couldn't see. But as wise as he appears to be, and he loves carving wood, he's the one who carved those stone talking heads that you get in Dark Souls 2. They originated here, and he's the one who carved them, these things. I wanted to show them to you. Goth is the guy who made them. And that's one of the other things that irritates me about Dark Souls 2, is that they're like, oh, they might be carved from wood. And here, the description just outright says, Goth is imprisoned here, and he carved them during his imprisonment as a way of reaching enlightenment? I mean, wow.
A visitor, have we? Thou must be the one who freed Artorias. That old friend he was. Thanks to thee, he left this world with honor intact. And here I am, retired and blind. Of little help to thee, I'm afraid. If thou seekest to explore this domain, be wary of a black dragon. I fear thee no match for this terrible beast. There's very little to be said. What good is a dog with no hares to hunt? But I'm lucky to be alive, I suppose.
Now, I find it interesting, and rather hilarious. There is a reason that Goth sells dung pies. You would not expect one of Gwyn's four knights to sell dung pies. The implication here is that because Goth is imprisoned, and he's basically in a jail cell, this is his own shit that he's selling you here. He's selling you his own turds. Oh, FromSoft, you and your subtle insinuations. And also, his great arrows, he makes them himself. Which is a good skill for a knight to have when his main weapon is a bow. But I guess we're not going to get the bulk of Goff's dialogue here. I had forgotten that you actually have to defeat Calamite first, so we're going to do that in the next episode.
Farewell, human. Lead thy life as thou seest fit.
This is the kind of character, and here I wanted to show you guys. You can see the pine resin actually seeping out of his helmet and caked on it and dried. We get the sense from speaking with him that he's actually very intelligent and very wise. And this is another thing Marcus pointed out well in the past now, is that there's a certain amount of irony. Miyazaki really loves flawed...
Well, thou comest again. Thou art a strange one. Farewell, human. Lead thy life.
Flawed characters, that is. And, pretty nearly every character in his stories has a flaw. Goff, in spite of being all wise and eloquent, he has no idea that his helmet is packed with pine resin and that he's not actually blind. So, there we go, guys. We're going to wrap up the footage for now, but as promised, take a look at this excerpt from the Mighty No. 9 backer email. Take a minute to read through this and, you know, just get a sense for the difference in attitude that the indie studios have from the AAA guys. The indie studios are just so willing to engage with their audiences and so willing to ask for feedback, which most AAA studios don't give a damn about. Frankly, they can't be bothered, or they just aren't aware. So I just wanted to show you guys this as a little bit of, I don't know, a point of interest, really. In any case, now I'm going to wrap up the episode. Thank you guys for joining me on this rather awkward black screen note, and I will see you all next time.